1, 2, 3. All right.
All right, the title today, well, happy Sabbath to all those here today.
Happy Sabbath, brother.
Those on the phone line and tuning in live on the internet. Peace.
Peace.
Today's lesson is called The Common Temptation. And usually when we think of temptations, we've been taught that it's only been, you know, Satan trying to tempt us or putting something in front of us to trip us up. But the temptations that we're going to speak on today are trials, tribulations that go on in your life that we aren't immediately expecting. You know, growing up in church, they say when you come into the Word, everything is all good. So that's what we expect.
Mm-hmm.
When you come to the truth, it's the total opposite of what we were told.
Mm-hmm.
Just to let you know what temptations mean, it's not on the handout, but we're going to run to Deuteronomy chapter 4 real quick. Let you know what that word temptation actually means. We're going to go to Deuteronomy chapter 4. We're going to pick it up at 34 real quick. Let's help us better get a better understanding of why we pray. Deliver us from evil. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And this is what he speaks of in Revelation chapter 3 and 10. He's going to deliver us from the hour of temptation, which is to try the whole world. Because through the temptations is how he delivered us out of our first captivity. And through temptations is how he's going to deliver us out of our second. Being in this present captivity and time we are in now. So we're going to pick up at Deuteronomy chapter 4, read verse 33 and verse 34.
Did ever people hear the voice of God speaking out of the midst of fire, as thou hast heard and lived?
No, he only dealt with one nation of people. That's the children of Israel. Go ahead.
Or have God assayed to go and take him a nation from the midst of another nation?
How's he going to do that?
By temptations.
By temptations.
By signs.
By signs.
And by wonders.
And by wonders.
And by war.
And by war.
And by a mighty hand.
Uh-huh.
And by a stretched out arm.
Mm-hmm.
And by great terrors, according to all that the Lord your God did for you in Egypt before your eyes.
All right, so you see the temptations, that's all the signs and wonders he put on Egypt. So our temptations are our trials we go through
mm-hmm.
in this walk. Like I said, when I first came into truth, I thought everything was going to be all good.
Mm-hmm.
As soon as I brought it to my mom, like, I don't want to hear it. And I was like shocked. I was surprised. I didn't know what was going on. All right, and the reason why this lesson is called the common temptations is because we all been there. Right, we all go through that. When we first get into the truth, we take it to our family, and they're the first ones to turn on us.
Mm-hmm.
So it's good to know that you ain't the only one going through it. So it makes the walk a little easier. And we're going to go to another script that's not on the handout. Ecclesiastes chapter 4, just to show you that it's better to have somebody with you when you're going through these temptations.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to go to Ecclesiastes. And we're going to pick it up at verse 9. When you get there, brother, go ahead and read.
Two are better than one, because they have a good reward for their labor.
Uh-huh.
For if they fall, the one will lift up his fellow.
See, if you're working with somebody, you having a rough time, you got your buddy there, your partner there to lift you up.
Amen.
What happens if you ain't got nobody with you? Go ahead.
But woe to him that is alone when he falleth. For he have not another to help him up.
Mm-hmm.
If two lie together, then they have heat. But how can one be warm alone?
Okay. You're all by yourself. Go ahead.
And if one prevail against him, two shall withstand him. And the threefold cord is not easily broken.
All right, that's good. All right, so it's always good to know. Switch.
Hand hold. I'll take the hand. Check.
Testing 1 2 1 2. All right, give us a
one,
second.
1 2 3.
While we get situated. Is this on? My mic on? Check, check. It's good. All right. All right, so we're gonna get into these temptations. We're gonna see what happened to the master at first, because the same thing he endured, we as fellow servants have to endure the same thing. Like I said, when you know somebody else has been through it, it's a little easier to have them with you when you fall.
Right.
So we're going to go to Isaiah chapter 59. Let's go to Isaiah chapter 59. Because these temptations are common. Our situations, our trials are not unique to us. Everybody's been through it.
Testing 1 2 1 2 3.
So let's pick it up. Let's see what happened with the master, what he saw, and what happened when he came down. So we're going to go to Isaiah. This is a typo. Go to Isaiah 59. We're going to pick it up at verse 14 instead of 1. Isaiah chapter 59, pick it up at verse 14. Go ahead, brother.
And judgment is turned away backwards, and justice standeth afar off. For truth is fallen in the street, and equity cannot enter.
Right, that's what we're seeing now. Ain't no truth here. No judgment. It's all wickedness. Go ahead.
Yea, truth faileth, and he that departeth from evil maketh himself a prey.
Right, so we try to do good in this world, and they looking at us like we evil. Mm-hmm. Right, we try to do the opposite of what the world is doing, and they hate us. But we gonna figure out why in a second. Go ahead.
And the Lord saw it, and it displeased him that there was no judgment.
The Lord seeing all this, and he was getting fed up. So what did he do after that? Go ahead.
And he saw that there was no man, and wondered that there was no intercessor.
So what happened?
Therefore, his arm brought salvation unto him, and his righteousness, it sustained him.
All right, that's good. That's why in the parable, we see he said when he had the vineyard, he said, I'm sure they're going to reference my son.
Right.
So he sent his son, and what happened?
They killed his son.
They
killed him.
Are we any better than the Lord? No. So let's go to John 17, and we're going to see why they, in fact, these common temptations happen to us when we start walking in the Word of God. John chapter 17, and pick it up at verse 6. Go ahead and read.
I have manifested thy name unto the men which thou gavest me out of the world.
Mm-hmm.
Thine they were, and thou gavest them me, and they have kept thy word.
That's us. We keep this word. We heard this word, and we keep it unto this day. Go ahead.
Now they have known that all things whatsoever thou hast given me are of thee.
Mm-hmm.
For I have given unto them the word which thou gavest me, and they have received them, and have known shortly that I came out from thee, and they have believed that thou didst send me.
Yes, sir. Skip down to verse 14. Skip up to verse 14 and go ahead.
I have given them thy word.
So he gave us his word. Go ahead.
And the world have hated them.
The world hate us. The world hate the followers of Christ. Mm-hmm. Why is that?
Because they are not of the world.
Uh-oh. We're not of the world anymore. Go ahead.
Even as I am not of the world.
So we want to be just like Christ, who is never of the world. Mm-hmm. Go ahead and read.
I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but thou shouldest keep them from the evil.
Mm-hmm.
They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world.
All right, so Christ wasn't of the world, and what happened to Christ, though?
They killed him.
Doing to Christ?
They killed him.
So we got to expect the same things. All right, this little persecution we go through for my family ain't nothing compared to them putting a knife to our neck. Go ahead and read.
Verse 17. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is true.
So we are sanctified through the word of God. Let's jump back to John chapter 15. It's not on the handout. We'll go to John chapter 15. And we got to understand that we're going to the same trials that Christ went through. These are common temptations that we should expect. Go ahead. John chapter 15, pick it up at verse 1. When you get there, brother, go ahead and read.
I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman.
Uh-huh.
Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away.
So if you ain't applying this word, you're getting taken out the way. Go ahead.
And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit.
All right, so when it say he purges it, I mean he's trying to bear more fruit. So he puts you under some more trials and temptations. So you'll bear more fruit. Go ahead.
Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you.
That's the only way you're going to be clean. That's the start of it. Skip down to verse 18. Go ahead.
If the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you.
Right. Don't sweat it. They hated God. Of course they're going to hate us. Go ahead and read.
19. If you were of the world would love his own.
All right. So if everybody love you, you know you're on the wrong track.
Right.
If everybody's speaking well of you, you're not in this truth. Or you haven't fully committed to the word of God yet. Because this is what Christ is saying. If you were of the world would love his own. Go ahead.
But because you are not of the world.
So we ain't of the world, what's going to happen?
But I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hate you.
Yeah, they're just going to hate you because they hate God. Go ahead.
Remember the word that I said unto you. The servant is not greater than his Lord.
Right, so if they did it to God himself, of course they're going to do it to us. Go ahead and read.
If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you.
Without a doubt. Go ahead.
If they have kept my saying, they will keep yours also.
Right, so if they follow this word, they'll follow your word because that's where it's coming from out of this book. Mm-hmm. They'll be right along with you, right in line. Go ahead.
But all these things will they do unto you for my name's sake, because they know not him that sent me.
Yeah, they don't know the Father. Go ahead.
If I had not come and spoken unto them, they had not had sin. But now they have no cloak for their sin.
Right, this whole book is here. You ain't got no cloak. You can't get away. Go ahead and read.
He that hateth me hateth my Father also.
All right, so if you ain't keeping this word of God, you hate the Father. Go ahead and read.
If I had not done among them the works which none other man did, they had not had sin. But now they have both seen and hated me, both me and my Father.
So this is already written that it will take place. Go ahead and read. Verse 25.
But this cometh to pass that the word might be fulfilled that is written in their law. They hated me without a cause.
Right. They have no reason to hate you. All we're doing is following what the book said.
That's right.
They're going to hate you without a cause.
Mm-hmm.
It's nothing we're doing wrong. It's just already written. That's going to happen. They did it to God. They're going to do it to his servants.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Let's go to Luke 8. We're going to pick up the parable of the sower really quick. And if you don't know any better, you'll end up like this person here. And this is what this whole lesson stems from. Luke chapter 8, we're going to pick it up at verse 4. We're not really concerned about the whole parable. We just want to pull one of these seeds out and identify what really took place. So this is Luke chapter 8, and we're going to pick it up at verse 4. Go ahead and read. Yes, sir.
And when much people were gathered together and were come to him out of every city, he spake by a parable.
Uh-huh.
A sower went out to sow his seed, and as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and it was trodden down, and the fowls of the air devoured it.
All right. So a sower went out to sow a seed, and as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and it was trodden down, and the fowls of the air devoured it. Go ahead to verse 6. This is what we want to identify. Verse 6. Go ahead.
And some fell upon a rock. And as soon as it was sprung up, it withered away because it lacked moisture.
All right, let's skip down to verse 11 and see what this actually means. Go ahead.
Now the parable is this: the seed is the word of God.
Mm-hmm. Skip down to verse 13.
They on the rock
are they which, when they hear, receive the word with joy.
Oh, so these that landed on the rock, they hear the word, receive the word with joy. I don't know how many people I done talked to that was, oh, we Israel, oh, you got to do this, oh, the Sabbath day, really? Next, say, oh, I'm coming out, brother. Give me a number, I'm coming. Mm-hmm. Next week, no show.
Cricket.
Or, in fact, Cricket. If they do show up, they hear for about 3 weeks or so, a month, and then some problems arise, and they're not here no more.
Right.
And we're going to see it. Go ahead.
Middle of 13.
Yes.
These have no root, which for a while believe, and in time of temptation fall away.
See, when it get a little rough, when them trials come up, when you get that persecution from your family, nobody want to chill with you no more, you can't deal with it. Oh, it's too hard, man. I didn't know. I wasn't expecting this. Because we've been taught that as soon as you come into the word, everything's going to be great.
Right.
Like the organ's going to be playing, angels singing and everything, right? But that ain't the case. Nobody want to do the word. Nobody want to follow it. Nobody likes those that are upright, as we read in Isaiah 59 and John 17. All right? So if he would have heard some of this stuff, maybe the temptation wouldn't have took him by surprise. So we're going to read a little bit about it. Let's go back to the Old Testament. Let's go to Jeremiah chapter 20. 14? No, we good, man. Because we only concerned about that temptation that caused those seeds to fall away, even though they received the word with joy. So we're going to go back to Jeremiah and see the same thing. He just reacted a little different. Jeremiah chapter 20. We're going to pick it up. It's not on the handout. I'm sorry. Jeremiah chapter 20. Pick it up at verse 7. When we get there, brother, go ahead and read.
Oh, Lord, thou hast deceived me.
Oh, he felt like the Lord deceived him. Why? Go ahead.
And I was deceived.
Uh-huh.
Thou art stronger than I.
Yes.
And I has prevailed.
So the Lord prevailing over him. Why is this? What's going on?
I am in derision daily. Everyone mocketh me.
Oh, everyone mocketh you. You see, when you come to word at first, most of the stuff takes place at home. Oh, you a Jew now, huh? Yeah. You don't eat no swine no more, huh? Everybody, he said, I'm in derision daily. Everyone mocketh me. Right? So what we expect when we come in the word is everybody to love us. Mm-hmm. But it's the opposite.
Yes, sir.
He said, I'm in derision daily. Mm-hmm. Somebody always at my neck. Somebody's always teasing me. Somebody's always mocking me. You know, I had my own auntie. She made cupcakes and all that. She said, you can have a cupcake. Ain't no pork in it. I'm like, come on now.
Game.
Come on. Go ahead. Verse 8.
For since I spake, I cried out. I cried violence and spoil.
Uh-huh.
Because the word of the Lord was made a reproach unto me and a derision daily.
He said, for since I spake, I cried out. I cried violence. This is terrible. And spoil because the word of the Lord was made a reproach unto me. And the derision daily. I'm telling you, everybody was at my neck. I was in college at the time when I found the word. Mm-hmm. It was coming from every direction. Go ahead. It happened to Jeremiah as well. Go ahead. He's going to tell you.
Then I said, I will not make mention of him.
He said, you know what? Y'all got it. Y'all won. I ain't going to talk about the Lord no more. Y'all got it. Go ahead and read.
Nor speak any more in his name.
He tried at least.
He did try.
I tried it before too. But this, they talk enough. You're going to explode. Go ahead and read. It's the same thing that happened with Jeremiah.
But his word was in mine heart as a burning fire, shut up in my bones. And I was weary with forbearing, and I could not stay.
Right.
For I heard the defaming of many, fear on every side.
Right. So he said it was, but his word was in mine heart as a burning fire, shut up in my bones. I was weary with forbearing, and I could not stay. Right. You listen to somebody talk about God like they know everything. It's only so long you can keep quiet.
Mm-hmm.
Until you know what? And bust the book open.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Start at 10 again.
For I heard the defaming of many.
Many. So you're hearing people talk behind his back on every side.
Right.
Constantly. You hear about what he's doing now? I think he's in the cold over there. I think he done went crazy. He over there with them people every Sabbath. I heard they be kneeling down and, you know, you heard you got to take your shoes off and all kind of stuff in there. Go ahead and read.
Fear on every side. Report, say they, and we will report it.
Yeah, we're going to report this. You done gone crazy. We need to call the psych people or something. He needs to go to the mental ward or something because he done fell off his rocker. Go ahead and read.
All my familiars watch for my halting, saying, peradventure.
Yeah, so when they say, all my familiars watch for my halting, they're like, this is just a phase.
Mm-hmm.
We know Crazy Joe, you know, he's going to get back to his old ways in a second.
Teach, brother.
This is just a little phase he's going through. Mm-hmm. You know he wanted to be a Muslim last year. Go ahead and read.
Peradventure, he will be enticed, and we shall prevail against him, and we shall take our revenge on him.
So sounds like the person, the seed in Luke 8 who rejoiced, and as soon as that he got that word and temptation hit, he should have been reading some of Jeremiah, maybe. He would have been in his truth still.
Mm-hmm.
Because we're reading about somebody in Luke 8, that seed, that's a lake of fire if you don't keep it to the end. If you fall away, it's over. You know? So if he had read this, maybe he would have continued in the word. That's why they say
life and death is in the power of the tongue.
That's right.
If nobody tell you, you don't know. Mm-hmm. So if he expecting everything to be joyous when he come in the word, and it's the exact opposite, he ain't going to know what to do. All right, go ahead and read verse 11.
Verse 11. But the Lord is with me as a mighty, terrible one. Therefore, my persecutors shall stumble.
Right. You're going to have the last laugh. It's all good. Jeremiah knew it. At the end of the day, the Lord going to take up for you. Vengeance is his. All the folks that was mocking you, troubling you, the Lord going to deal with them. Just stay to this word, man. Stay in this word. Go ahead.
And they shall not prevail.
Mm-hmm.
They shall be greatly ashamed.
Greatly ashamed. Go ahead.
For they shall not prosper. Their everlasting confusion shall never be forgotten.
What does everlasting mean? Forever, right?
Forever.
Don't sound too good. Read that last part again.
Their everlasting confusion shall never be forgotten.
He said never. Don't mock the servants of God. It ain't going to never be forgotten. Mm-hmm. Let's go to Matthew chapter 4. Now we're going to get into what's on the paper, on the handout. We see Jesus was coming down. We saw it in Isaiah 59. He said, the truth felleth in the street, so I got to come down here. You see how they treated him. You know, as soon as the word is poured out on you, that's when the troubles start. And we're going to see this right now. As soon as the Lord was baptized, immediately, temptations came. So we're going to read Matthew chapter 4. We're going to pick it up at verse 1. When you get there, brother, go ahead and read.
Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil.
All right, and this is right after he got baptized. Literally in Matthew chapter 3, at the end of the Matthew chapter 3 is where the Lord was baptized. And as soon as he was baptized, then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. As soon as he got baptized, the trouble hit. Mm-hmm. So as soon as we get baptized with this word, that's when affliction started to come. And if we're not expecting it, we ain't going to know what to do. Mm-hmm. All right, that's what this lesson is all about. Go ahead.
And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterwards a hunger.
Uh-huh.
And when the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God, command these stones to be made bread.
Mm-hmm.
But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God.
That's the only way you're going to get through these temptations and trials, through the word of God. Nothing earthly, nothing physical, it's all spiritual. All right, so let's go to Luke chapter 12, because as soon as you come in this word, the problems and the trouble come from your own familiars. As we read in Jeremiah 20, the trouble start at home, and we're going to see why. I didn't try to take this to my family all excited, and as soon as I took it to them, they started shaking their head. I was confused. I was like, you've been telling me to read my Bible all my life. I start reading my Bible. Now it's a problem. I'm confused now. I was running to them with joy. And that smile was turned upside down quickly.
Right.
He was like, oh, you ain't got to follow all that stuff. I was confused, man. But we're going to see why that separation is there. We're going to pick it up. We're going to see what the master said. Luke chapter 12, we're going to pick it up at verse 49. When you get there, brother, go ahead and read.
I am come to send fire on the earth.
Wait a minute. I thought Jesus came to send peace on earth, goodwill towards man, all that stuff. Mm-hmm. Is that the case? Go ahead.
I am come to send fire on the earth. And what will it? And what will I if it be already kindled?
Right. If somebody already did it already, what am I here for? I'm bringing this. It's me. I'm bringing the fire. Mm-hmm. Go ahead and read.
But I have a baptism to be baptized with. And how I am straitened till it be accomplished.
He said, but I have a baptism to be baptized with, and how am I straitened till it be accomplished? I'm not cool till I do this thing.
Right.
Till I'm persecuted and I die for y'all, I'm not cool. I'm not straightened. I'm not happy until this affliction occurs and I overcome it. That's what we got to expect coming in the word, to overcome. Mm-hmm. That the affliction's going to come. These temptations are going to come. Mm-hmm. And it's not exclusive to you. But it's going to happen to all your brothers and sisters. We're all going through it. So when you're going through it, you know that these same afflictions are being accomplished in your brethren throughout the world. Go ahead and read.
Suppose that I am come to give peace on the earth?
No, no. He said, you think I came to send peace on the earth? Who told you that? This is what I came to bring. Let them know.
I tell you that, but rather division.
No, I didn't come to send peace. I want y'all divided. I want to know who's going to serve me. I want to know who on my team.
That's right.
Right? So when I come with my reward, I know who to give it to.
That's right.
It ain't going to be no doubt about it. Suppose you that I come to give peace on this earth, I tell you nay, but rather division. Go ahead and read.
52. For from henceforth there shall be five in one house divided, three against two and two against three.
You lucky if it's three against two. In most cases nowadays, it's eight against one.
Mm.
Should I go to a family cookout, it's 30 against one.
Mm-hmm.
You lucky if you get two on three. What it say? For from henceforth there shall be five in one house divided, three against two and two against three. Go ahead.
The father shall be divided against the son,
mm-hmm.
against the father, the mother against the daughter, and the daughter against the mother.
All right, you see, the father shall be divided against the son. In most households, the son and the father real close. Mm-hmm. But as soon as that word come in, not close no more. Same thing with a mother and a daughter. As soon as that word come in, they splitting that. Who do you love, right? You love them more than me? Or do you love me more than them? We're going to see. We're going to find out. That's the whole purpose. Go ahead and read.
The mother-in-law against the daughter-in-law.
Mm-hmm.
And the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law.
All right, let's go read it again. Let's go to Matthew chapter 10. Because this is what we got to expect coming in this word. If nobody ever tell you, you might get weary and fall away.
That's right.
And we don't want that.
We don't want it.
So. Matthew chapter 10. And we're going to pick it up at verse 24. Matthew chapter 10, verse 24. When you get there, brother, go ahead and read.
The disciple is not above his master, nor the servant above his Lord.
No way, shape, or form. The disciple is not above his master. So whatever happened to him, you got to expect it's coming to you. Go ahead.
Nor a servant is above his Lord.
Uh-huh.
It is enough for the disciple to be as his master.
Yeah, that's enough. To be as your master. You're not trying to do anything more than what Christ did. You shouldn't expect more or less. Go ahead.
And the servant as his Lord. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub.
All right. It said if they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, which means prince of devils. They called Jesus the God of this world, the God of this heaven and earth, the prince of devils. So what do you think they're going to call you? Literally, I kid you not, when I came in the truth, my mama said I was working for Satan. She said I was in the coach.
Jeez.
And I'm pretty sure everybody in here has heard that before, one time or another, mm-hmm. that you in the coach. You working for Satan. Read that again. Verse 25 again.
Okay. It is enough for the disciple to be as his master and the servant as his Lord. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more shall they call them of his household?
They're going to call you worse than that. If they call Jesus, our creator, that, they got something worse for you. I'm telling you, if they did it to our Lord and Savior, they'd have no problem doing it to you. Let's skip down to verse 34. Skip down to verse 34. We're going to read what we just read in Luke 12. Go ahead.
Think not that I am come to send peace on earth.
There it is again. The Lord himself said, I didn't come to send peace here. Go ahead and read.
I came not to send peace, but a sword.
I came to bring that word of God, which is in fact going to divide y'all. It's going to split y'all up. Go ahead.
For I am a man at variance against his father, and the daughter against her mother, and the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. A man's foes shall be they of his own household. He that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me.
Right. So it's not exclusive just father and mother. Your own cousins, your best friends, husbands, wives. I done heard stories about wives leaving their husbands over the truth. Best friends splitting up. I done lost best friends, cousins, all that because of the word of God. But I love the Lord more than them,
Amen.
Obviously, because I'm here every Sabbath.
Amen.
And we got to arm ourselves with that same mindset that it's all about the word. If it happened to Jesus, you got to expect it's going to happen to you. So you just got to deal with it. So read 35 again.
For I am come to set a man at variance against his father.
That was his whole purpose. He wanted to see who's going to serve him. That's it. I came to do this. I split y'all up. I want to know who really serving me and who just playing. Who going to fall away with this little temptation? Who going to serve me through that? Go ahead.
And the daughter against her mother.
Uh-huh.
And the daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law.
Mm-hmm.
A man's foes shall be they of his own household.
Start in your house. Mm-hmm. Your enemies going to come from within. You see how Jesus' brothers were treating him? Go what? Mm-hmm. For what, man? What he say to them? Your time always ready. Better chill out. You know, a prophet. That's why he said a prophet ain't accepted in his own country.
That's right.
It start at home. Mm-hmm. The person they grew up with, after reading his Bible, is not the person they become. They be like, you looking real strange. You looking real unfamiliar. I never heard this before. You grew up celebrating Christmas.
Right.
You better than us now.
Mm-hmm.
You used to eat swine.
Mm-hmm.
We used to go to Red Lobster
mm-hmm.
on your birthday.
Right.
What's going on?
What's happening?
You in a coat now? You better than us? No, I just love the Lord.
Amen.
That's it.
Amen, brother.
It's nothing personal. Go ahead and read.
37. He that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. He that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me.
Mm-hmm.
And he that taketh not his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me.
Listen, you got to take up your cross, though. You can't say, oh, it's getting too hard. I need somebody else's cross. Because if you get somebody else's cross, it might be heavier than the one you was carrying, and you end up wanting your cross back. Right? You got to bear your own burden. It's the life you chose. You got to deal with it. So ain't nothing too hard. The Lord said, I shall lose nothing. If he lose you, he didn't lose you. You just was never his.
Amen.
So you was playing.
Woo.
All right, so verse 38, and he that taketh not his cross and followeth after me is not worthy of me. All right, go ahead and read.
He that findeth his life shall lose it, and he that loseth his life for my sake shall find it.
Shall find it. I've seen it in the verse. People give up everything for this world. They give up God. For what? With fame, fortune, all that? No, it's not worth it, because in the end, it's the lake of fire. I'd rather lose my life now. I'd rather hide my life in Christ, and which will be revealed to me when he get back, because that's what it's all about. Let's go to Luke chapter 6. You're going to see some more of this. Luke chapter 6. Luke chapter 6. We're going to pick it up at verse 20. Luke chapter 6, verse 20. When you get there, brother, go ahead and read.
And he lifted up his eyes on his disciples and said, blessed be the poor, for yours is the kingdom of God.
Yeah, we're not striving to be rich. It's saying in the Bible, don't strive to be rich.
Mm-hmm.
All right, you can be poor, go through it now, right, because your reward is with Christ. All right, saying he lifted up his eyes on his disciples and said, blessed be ye poor. So you good. Your situation, it's perfect. Stay this way until I come back. This is the word of God. This is God himself telling you, you good. You fine. You don't need nothing else. Blessed be ye poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Go ahead.
Blessed are ye that hunger.
So you hungering now? Don't trip. It's okay. Hunger now. Go ahead.
For ye shall be filled.
You're going to be filled at the end of the day. You stay in this word. You're going to be filled. I got you. Listen to me. Blessed are ye that hunger now. So hunger, go ahead. Go ahead and read, bro.
Blessed are ye that weep now.
Blessed are ye that weep now. You're going through it. Perfect. Good. Go ahead and read.
For ye shall laugh.
You're going to laugh at the end of the day. You know, take your blows now. Mm-hmm. Get it now. Go ahead and read.
Blessed are ye.
But men shall hate you.
So men going to hate you. So when you come in this word, men is going to hate you. So we should expect that. He say we blessed though. So it says, blessed are ye when men shall hate you. So when people hate on you for just simply doing the word of God,
mm-hmm.
you are blessed. This is Jesus. This is God telling you this. Blessed are ye when men shall hate you. And what else? What else they going to do?
And when they shall separate you from their company.
Yeah, I ain't trying to kick with him, man. He crazy, man. All he do is talk about the Bible, man. He good. Leave him alone. Blessed are you when they do that. When they separate you from their company for the word of God, blessed are ye. Go ahead.
And shall reproach you and cast you and cast out your name as evil for the Son of Man's sake.
Rejoice ye in that day and leap
for joy.
So you're supposed to be rejoicing. When we get that with persecution, when we go through the afflictions, we shouldn't be down. We shouldn't be trying to throw in the towel like, oh, this is too hard. Think my family coming against me. They don't invite me to none of the parties no more. I don't know. This is too hard.
Right.
No. This is God telling you, rejoice ye in that day and leap for joy. Why? Go ahead.
For behold, your reward is great.
Because your reward is great in heaven. This right. ain't worth nothing.
Sir.
This life ain't worth anything. So if you're poor now, stay poor. You're hungry, stay hungry. If you're sad, stay sad. Because your reward is in heaven. It's going to be revealed when Christ get back. That's it. You're good. You're at the place you're in now is where you're supposed to be. As long as you're abiding in the word of God, you're good. So rejoice ye in that day and leap for joy. For behold, your reward is great in heaven. Go ahead.
For in like manner did their fathers
unto the prophets.
So this happened to the prophets too. This happened to the previous disciples, the previous followers of God. This is the common temptations. This is what is to be expected coming into this truth.
That's right.
Your situation, your afflictions are not unique to you. This has happened before. We just read in the Old Testament, Jeremiah, as soon as he came in the word, they was all at him. Every side. They had him hit him in derision daily. Right? This is what is to be expected. Go ahead.
But woe are rich.
Hey, if you want to be rich, now I told you we're fine. You're poor, you're fine, but if you want to be rich, go ahead. He said, woe, though. I'm saying woe. But woe unto you that are rich. Go ahead.
For you have received your consolation.
All right, so this is what you want? You want it now? Is this what you want? Are you sure? All right. But woe unto you. You want to be happy? You want to be rich now? Go ahead. Comes at a cost, though.
Mm-hmm.
Comes at a price. Those that find their life shall lose it. All right, go ahead.
Woe unto you that are full.
Uh-oh. I told you it was good being poor and hungry, but now you want to be full. You want to just, you know, work that overtime. I need this money, so I got to work the Sabbath. I need that. I need that overtime. I really need this money.
Come on now.
Go ahead.
For ye shall hunger.
Mm-mm. He said, woe unto you that are full, for ye shall hunger at the end. Right? We saw, you know, the parable of the rich man and the poor man who was sitting at the rich man's table eating the crumbs.
Right.
All right? And the resurrection, the robes turned totally different.
That's right.
Now the poor man on top in the kingdom of God and that rich man in the late. Which one do you want? Do you want it now or you want it later?
Mm-hmm.
You know, cry now, laugh later, or laugh now, cry later. Go ahead and read.
Woe unto you that laugh now, for ye shall mourn and weep.
I'm telling you now. Go ahead.
Woe unto you when all men shall speak well of you.
All right, this can't be the truth because everybody talking about me. This can't be the truth. I don't know about this. It ain't supposed to be like this. Everybody's supposed to like me because I serve God. Mm-mm. What'd it say?
Woe unto you when all men shall speak well of you.
If everybody's speaking well of you, it's a problem. Mm-hmm. You're probably not living all the way. You're probably not 100 with God. Woe unto you when all men shall speak well of you. Why?
For so did their fathers to the false prophets.
Uh-oh, you might be false. If everybody like you, and you supposedly in this truth, but you got all these worldly friends that speak highly of you, you might be false in here. Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 4. We're going to pick it up at verse 1. 1 Peter chapter 4. And we're going to pick it up at verse 1. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 1. When you get there, brother, go ahead and read.
For as much then as Christ has suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind.
All right, so as much then as Christ have suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind. You're not escaping it. You should be encouraging this. You should be anticipating this affliction.
Right.
All right, it says, for as much then as Christ have suffered for us in the flesh, so that means we're going to suffer. It says, arm yourself likewise with the same mind. Why is this a good thing to suffer in the flesh? What does this actually mean? Go ahead and read.
For he that have suffered in the flesh have ceased from sin.
Nah, you can't cease from sin. Mm-hmm. You can't be perfect. That law ain't good no more. You can't be perfect. There's nothing you can do. Christ did it all for you. There's nothing you have to do anymore. That's not quite true according to this word here.
Mm-hmm.
For he that hath suffered in the flesh, so if you're suffering for keeping a Sabbath day, you're being ridiculed and persecuted for not eating swine no more.
Come on.
What does that mean? You have now ceased from sin. Now, we make mistakes along the way, but this is the word of God here.
Come on.
It says we cease from sin, don't it?
That's right.
Go ahead and read.
Verse 2. That he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh to the lust of men. but to the will of God.
Right. We don't care about being rich no more. We don't care about being full all the time. Because we know there's a time and place for that, and that's at the return of God.
Amen.
It says that, it says in the flesh, it says, for he that have suffered in the flesh have ceased from sin, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh to the lust of men. So before this truth, we was all trying to be rich, trying to be movie stars, NBA players, have all the women, have right. all the men, mm-hmm. have all the clothes, have all the cars, houses. Mm-hmm. Now that we are living in the Word of God, we ain't even worried about that fleshly stuff no more.
Right.
It don't even matter. What do it matter if you're going to die anyway? It don't go to the grave with you. A show don't go to the lake of fire. Matter of fact, it may go to the lake of fire with you, but it's going to be burnt up like you. Go ahead and read.
Verse 3. For the time past of our life may suffice us to have wrought the will of the Gentiles.
That don't sound like the will of God. We were trying to do what the Gentiles naturally do. They want to be rich. They want to have the limelight. It's their time, though. It's not ours. The servant of God's time is at a assigned time when Christ come back. Go ahead.
Right. When we walked in lasciviousness, lust, excess of wine, revelings, banquetings, and abominable idolatry.
Right. We always want to hit them strip clubs up. We always need that excess of wine. We want getting drunk all the time, reveling out of control, banquetings. We always at the next party. Every Friday night, we at the next party. Sunday, it's a party. Oh, I'm there. Monday, it's a party. I'm there, too. And abominable idolatry. You got the Easter, Christmas, all these abominable idolatries, right? Yeah. This is before we came into the knowledge of the word. Mm-hmm. Go ahead and read.
Verse 4. Wherein they think it's strange that you run not with them.
Oh, so your friends, this is why your household, those of your household going to become your enemies, right? It say, wherein they think it's strange that you run not with them to the same excess of riot. So you better than us now? Friday night, you know we always go out to the club. I got to go to church, brother. What? You going to church on Friday night?
Friday?
What is wrong with you?
Crazy.
Yeah, we got these women, man. We about to, you know how we used to do? No, I'm good, brother. I'm about to study my book. What? Wherein they think it's strange that you changed. Brother, 2 weeks ago, you was just with us. Oh, man, I changed, man. I grew up. I learned the word of God. I got to follow it no matter what.
Amen.
So they're going to think it's strange. So expect all this, right? This shouldn't shock anybody unless no one told you before, but that's why we're here. That's why we come together on the Sabbath. To get that understanding, so we know what to expect. Go ahead.
Speaking evil of you.
Yeah, they're going to talk about you. Just know that for a fact. They're going to talk about you. Go ahead. Skip to 11.
If any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as the ability which God giveth.
Yes, sir.
That God in all things may be glorified.
We do this all to the glory of God. Go ahead.
Through Jesus Christ,
mm-hmm.
to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. Amen.
All right. So what's coming next when you enter this covenant with God? When you're starting to keep the commandments, the laws, and statutes, what's coming? Ira, what's coming? Go ahead.
Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you.
Uh-oh.
As though some strange thing happened unto you.
I kid you not. I was getting beat up when I first got in this word. Mm-hmm. I promised you about 17 months straight. I was getting my head beat in. I thought something was wrong. I thought I wasn't in the truth.
You gotta get corrected, brother.
It say, beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you. Don't think some strange thing happened. This is supposed to take place.
Mm-hmm.
Matter of fact, you already know you switching teams. You've been sinning against me your whole life. Now you want to act right, but I got to get you.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead.
But rejoice in so much as ye are partakers of Christ's suffering.
Right, that's why he said rejoice. But rejoice in as much as ye are partakers of Christ's suffering. So everything you're going through, Christ already went through it. The same issues, the ridicule from family and friends, mm-hmm. Christ already went through it. That's why the title of the lesson is The Common Temptations, which is meaning trials, afflictions. It's happened already. Happened to the prophets, happened to Christ.
Mm-hmm.
So it's going to happen to us. We got to glory and rejoice in it. That means you're in the truth. If this is happening to you, that means you are serving God.
Mm-hmm.
That's all that matters. Go ahead.
That when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy.
Why will you be glad when Christ get back? Because you stayed hungry. You stayed poor. You stayed sad. You stayed humble till his return. When he finally get here, your reward is with him, so you ready. Instead of being terrified because of all the wicked you did. And those people that decided not to follow the word. They say, woe to them that desire the day of the Lord. Mm. They scared. We rejoicing because we going through it. We going through the beating now. We going through the affliction, right? Mm-hmm. Our body is being destroyed daily. Something always in the bushes waiting for us. We don't never get a moment to chill. Maybe a few weeks go by without a little, you know, disturbance. But sure enough, it's coming again. Mm-hmm. Always. We always on our toes. Go ahead.
Verse 14. If ye be reproached in the name of Christ.
Right. So if you're doing this for Christ's sake, what?
Happy are ye.
So we should be happy. We're going through this for Christ's sake. And all my brothers and sisters that serve the Lord are. We're not alone. We all should be happy. We all going through it. Go ahead.
For the spirit of glory of God resteth upon you.
God our Father is glorying in you. Because you decided to take this walk and deal with the persecutions. And you walk in the walk that Christ walked. So he's glorying in you now. Go ahead and read.
On their part, he is evil spoken
of. Yeah, they don't know what they're talking about. They're going to talk crazy about you, your family and friends. They don't understand. That's too hard, man. I ain't dealing with that, what he deal with. He in some type of code or something. I don't know. I can't do it. I talked to my brother one day. He's like, man, the Sabbath from Friday night to Saturday. He said, man, I ain't keeping on Saturday, man. That's crazy. I ain't doing that. Sure. Go ahead.
But on your part, he is glorified.
Yeah, he's glorified. Go ahead.
But let none of you suffer as a murderer.
Don't be no murderer, though. If you're suffering for wrongdoing, then, I mean, it doesn't. It's just you deserve it, really. You get what you deserve. Like, you're earning it. You're earning the beating. You're not supposed to glory in that. The Lord ain't tripping over that. He ain't glorying in that. He don't care nothing about that. He's telling you, but let none of you suffer as a murderer. That's a commandment breaker. Of course you're going to suffer for that. Go ahead.
Or as a thief, or as an evildoer, or as a busybody in other men's matters.
Right. So don't suffer for wickedness. Suffer for righteousness' sake. Let's see someone who suffered for righteousness' sake. Let's go to Job. Let's see what happened with Job. We know the story of Job, so we ain't going to read that part, but we're going to get pick some other facts up. Different point of view. Right, because we know that as soon as you come into the word, the trouble starts at home. And if it happened to Job, it's going to happen to us. Because God said he was a perfect and upright man. He ain't say that about us. I know that. And look what he went through. He lost his kids. He lost his possessions, servants. He lost everything. Was sick, had boils all over his body. And he was 10 times more righteous than us. And he went through it, so we know we deserve it. We've been terrible from a youth. We've been wilding. We came out of the womb eating pork, swine, Christmas, all that. But Job didn't. He was a perfect upright man. But he still deserved it regardless of we born in sin. But to this magnitude, it's showing you that no matter how hard it gets, you still got to stick with it. But it's the common temptation. So Job went through it as well. Let's pick it up at verse 1.
There was a man in the land of Uz.
Job chapter 19. Pardon me. Job chapter 19 and pick it up at verse 1.
Okay. Then Job answered and said, how long will you vex my soul and break me in pieces with words?
All right, so Job's friends was there. And it was like, Job, I know you did something wrong. For all this to happen to you, I know. And that's what we can't be doing. When we see a brother or sister constantly going through it, that don't mean that they did something necessarily wicked. I'll tell you, when I was getting my head beat in for 17 months, telling you I had Kenny, Josh, Iffy all hitting me up, he was like, bro, you sure? You sure? You sure? And I was like, no, this is what comes with it. The more you know, the more gifts God gives you, the more trouble. I'm telling you, you held at a higher standard. Now, I got understanding very quick, early. I was at 23. Soon as I found the word, boom, boom. Preaching to my schoolmates, all that. So the minute I messed up once, it all came falling down on me. Mm-hmm. But as soon as I came in this word, the trouble hit. So it wasn't necessarily anything I did. That's just what comes with the territory. Serving the Lord, that's the common temptation. Everybody go through it, and we're going to see what happened to Job. We know what happened to Job. Let's see what's happening here, though. But his friends was unrighteous in their judgment. That's why he said, how long will you vex my soul and break me in pieces with words? Y'all trying to tear me down. Y'all supposed to be uplifted. Mm-hmm. Right? If you see a brother overtaken in a fault, you got to lift them up in the spirit of meekness. You got to raise it. You got to be there for them, right? Because this could be you. Y'all could switch places quick. Tables could turn real quick. So he said, how long will you vex my soul and break me in pieces with words? Verse 3.
These 10 times have ye reproached me. Ye are not ashamed that ye make yourselves strange to me.
So you talking to me, y'all done talked to me about 10 times. And y'all feel like y'all don't have no problem not being friends with me no more. Because the way y'all talking, I'm just stop messing with y'all. It say, these 10 times have you reproached me. Y'all, 10 times, man, the same thing. You are not ashamed that ye make yourself strange to me. Y'all don't consider that I'm getting irritated, that I'm finna really leave y'all alone. Go ahead and read.
And be it indeed that I have erred, my error remaineth with myself.
I know I'm not an error. This with me, though. I know it's my cross to bear. I know. It's in me. I know. Go ahead and read.
If indeed ye will magnify yourselves against me and plead against me, my reproach.
That's what we got a habit of doing. You thinking you more righteous than the next brother because he consistently going through it. That ain't the case. That's not always the case. If indeed he will magnify yourselves against me. So y'all not going through nothing right now, so y'all feel like y'all better than me at the moment. That's cool. And plead against me my reproach. Go ahead.
Know now that God hath overthrown me.
God did this to me. That's what you better know. It ain't nothing necessarily I did. God has done this to me. Know now that God hath overthrown me. It wasn't none of y'all. It wasn't no man. It was God. Go ahead.
And hath compassed me with his neck.
Yeah.
Behold, I cry out of wrong.
I'm heard up, man. I cry out of wrong. I know. Go ahead.
But I am not heard.
Lord, I'm sorry, but he ain't listening. He put his net up around me. He ain't trying to hear nothing I got to say. He done put all this evil on me. He said, behold, I cry out of wrong, but I'm not even heard. Go ahead.
I cry aloud, but there is no judgment.
No judgment. He ain't even pleading for me right now. He done turned his back completely on me. At least that's what it feel like. Because the trouble I'm in feel like the Lord has deserted me. Mm-hmm. Go ahead and read.
He hath fenced up my way that I cannot pass.
I'm locked up. I can't do nothing. Ain't nothing happening. I ain't prospering or anything. I done lost everything. Say, he hath fenced up my way that I cannot pass. If he had do this to Job, best believe he'd do it to you and me, every one of us. And he was way more righteous than us. That's what we got to understand. We cannot fold when these temptations come upon us.
Amen.
All right, go ahead.
And he hath set darkness in my path.
Yep.
He hath stripped me of my glory.
Yep, and stripped him of his glory. He hath stripped me of my glory. He lost everything, riches, his daughters, sons, they houses, servants. He lost everything. He was on top. Help. He had some real glory. If anybody had it, it was Job. He hath stripped me of my glory. Go ahead.
And taken the crown from my head.
Yes.
He hath destroyed me on every side.
Uh-huh.
And I am gone.
I am gone.
And mine hope hath he removed like a tree.
Like a tree. Like a tree is cut down. He done cut down my hope. I don't feel like I got no hope. I'm sitting here with boils and all over my body, and I lost everything. My wife talking crazy.
Right, right.
He done cut off my hope. It's over. Go ahead.
Verse 11. He hath also kindled his wrath against me.
He had kindled his wrath against each and every one of us just because he feel like it. Matter of fact, we know we deserve it because how wicked we was in our youth.
Mm-hmm.
Before we hit this truth. You know, it took me 23 years, some of us 50. You know how much trouble you done did all the way up till 50. You know you deserve something.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead.
And he counted me unto him as one of his enemies.
That's quickly. Those that do not keep the law of God hate God. That's the enemy.
That is right.
And you can read that in what, Romans chapter 8. Y'all think people say the law is not important. You don't keep the law, you're an enemy of God. And this is how he'll treat you. He'll treat you worse than this. Go ahead.
12. His troops come together.
His troops. He got troops. Now, there's two sets of troops he got. Remember, all the angels work for the Lord. In Psalms 34, say the angel of the Lord encampeth them round about that fear him.
That's right.
And delivereth him.
Mm-hmm.
Remember what Satan said to God? He said, oh, you got that hedge around Job. Well, he removed his hedge, and he sent some other troops there. You got evil angels there. They were coming to wreck shop. Go ahead. It says, he have also kindled his wrath against me, and he counted me unto him as one of his enemies. His troops come together. Go ahead. And what did they do?
And raise up their way against me and encamp around about my tabernacle.
You got a whole new set of troops encamping you. Before it was in the good holy angels protecting you. Now Satan requested that he remove that hedge. The angels dipped. And that new head, them other troops encamps you now.
Mm-hmm.
Like he said, he done shut up your way, put a fence around you. That's it. When the Lord put that on you, ain't nothing you can do. You just got to fight through and overcome like Job did. Go ahead.
He had put my brethren far from me.
That's what's going to happen when you come into this word. He had put my brethren far from me. My brothers, I don't talk to them like that. They think I'm crazy too. I'm not the only one. That's why it's a common temptation.
Mm-hmm.
Family members, he had put my brethren far from me. You come into this word, they're going to be far from me. Go ahead.
And mine acquaintance.
Friends.
And my acquaintance are very estranged from me.
You come in for you. Hey, brother, I ain't seen you in a minute, but I heard you've been on some type cult stuff. Is that true?
Is that true?
No. I just follow the word of God. You come in there with an open smile, with open arms. Hey. But like, hold up, man. He said, he had put my brethren far from me, and my acquaintance are very estranged from me. Go ahead. They act like they don't know me no more. Go ahead.
My kinfolk have failed.
His kinsfolk. His family. Told you to start at home. As soon as you come in the word, it's going to start at home. My enemies are they of my own household. Go ahead.
And my familiar friends have forgotten me.
Yeah, we don't mess with Ira no more, man. All he talk about is some Bibles and all that stuff, man. Don't even invite him over here. What about the people in his own crib, though? Go ahead.
Verse 15. They that dwell in mine house,
mm-hmm,
and my maids count me for a stranger.
Man, it's coming. Hey, enemies, going to be your household, right? That's war. They see a lot of trouble. You're going through a lot of trouble. They're like, I don't know, you know. And being brothers and sisters, knowing that this strife and this affliction is coming, we got to be better. We got to uplift each other. You can't point the finger thinking, you know, he don't really be in this Bible like that. How would you know? You should be uplifting each other. Read 15 again.
They that dwell in mine house and my maids count me for a stranger.
Mm-hmm. They're going to look at you strange in there. You start reading every Friday night, you shut down. They're going to look at you strange. He just go in this room and read his Bible. What's wrong with him? Go ahead.
I am an alien in their sight.
See, that's what Jesus said. I'm an alien to my mother's children. Same thing that happened with Christ. Same thing with Job. We all going to go through it. Go ahead.
I called my servant, and he gave me no answer.
He ain't even listening to you no more. You don't think you done went off the deep end. He don't even bother with you no more. I called my servant, and he gave me no answer. He ain't even respecting me. He ain't even responding. He think I'm crazy. Go ahead.
I entreated him with my mouth.
Mm-hmm.
My breath is strange to my wife.
Ain't that right? I know from personal experience that's going to happen. As soon as you get in that word, he'll split up your household. Husbands and wife ain't going to be cool no more. When y'all got married, everything was okay. 5 years later, you come into the truth. Now y'all divided. It said, my breath is strange to my wife. She ain't even messing with me. She don't recognize me no more. Go ahead.
Though I entreated for the children's sake of my own body.
It's me. Go ahead.
Yea, young children despise me.
Everybody.
I arose, and they spake against me.
That's what's going to happen, everybody.
All my inward friends abhor me, and they whom I love are turned against me.
Tell me that ain't what it feel like. Tell me that ain't happening to y'all. It's the common temptations. It's not unique to you. It says right here, all my inward friends abhor me. They ain't mess with me anymore. They hate me. They whom I loved are turned against me. The brother, one of your best friends you used to be able to call on and depend on, ain't there no more. Friends, families, mothers, aunts, can't call them no more. They think you're crazy. But it ain't unique to you. It's happened all before. That's why in the Bible it says you can't say nothing. There's something that's new because it's all been done. It's all happened. Wherefore, this is new. No, you can't say that. Mm-hmm. As you can see, it even happened to Job. And then we ran to Matthew chapter 10. Jesus was the one that did it to him. So he knew. That's why he said, they of my own household become enemies. And that's the same thing that happened to Job. All right, let's run to Acts chapter 14. We're going to see what happened with Paul. Because, you know, Paul made havoc of the church. He even had Stephen killed. And he went through some afflictions as well. Let's see how he dealt with it. See if he threw in the towel after this. Acts chapter 14, we're just going to pick it up in the middle of the story. They were at Lystra. Verse chapter 6, this is Paul. Go ahead.
And they were aware of it and fled to Lystra and Derbe, cities of Laconia,
mm-hmm.
and unto the region that lieth round about.
What they do there?
And there they preached the gospel.
They preached the gospel.
And there sat a certain man in Lystra, impotent in his feet, being crippled from his mother's womb, who never had walked.
Mm-hmm.
The same heard Paul speaking, who steadfastly beholding him and perceiving that he had faith to be healed, said with a loud voice, "Stand upright on thy feet."
Yeah, so this is a man that couldn't walk. Paul healed him. Let's see what the people did when they saw this. Go ahead.
And he leaped and walked.
Mm-hmm.
And when the people saw what Paul had done, they lifted up their voices, saying in the speech of Laconia, "The gods are come down to us in likeness of men."
All right, let's see. Paul, with a humble mind, let's see what he did. Because in most cases, us today, somebody call us a god, we're going to be like, yeah. I'm the god, I'm the man. No, let's see what Paul and them did after hearing that. It said the people, and when the people saw what Paul had done, they lifted up their voices, saying in the speech of the Lyconia, "The gods are come down to us in the likeness of men." Let's see how Paul and Barnabas took that. Go ahead.
And they called Barnabas Jupiter and Paul Mercurius, because he was the chief speaker.
Mm-hmm.
Then the priests of Jupiter, which was before their city, brought oxen and garlands.
Oh, my goodness. So they about to sacrifice to Barnabas and Paul. Barnabas and Paul. Let's see what they did. Go ahead.
Unto the gate, and would have done sacrifice with the people, which when the apostles Barnabas and Paul heard of, they rent their clothes and ran in among the people, crying out.
Right. So they know that number one commandment up there, thou shalt have no God. They was like, oh, no. Y'all not about to set us up.
I know that's right.
No, this ain't happening. Y'all not sacrificing to us as God. Go ahead.
15. And saying, "Sirs, why do you do these things? We also are men of like passions with you, and preach unto you that you should turn from these vanities unto the living God."
Listen, we just came here to preach y'all Jesus. All right, we just like y'all. We flesh and blood just like y'all. We just here to preach the gospel. Y'all don't need to be trying to serve us or sacrifice unto that. No. Go ahead and read.
"Which made heaven and earth and the sea and all things that are therein,
mm-hmm.
who in past time suffered nations to walk in their own ways. Nevertheless, he left not himself without witnesses, in that he did good and gave us rain from heaven and fruitful seasons, fulfilling our hearts with food and gladness. And with these sayings, scarce restrained they the people, that they had not done sacrifices unto
them." Right, mid-chop. They was about to cut the, and then they stopped.
Mm-hmm.
Folks, it's crazy. Go ahead.
Verse 19. "And there came thither certain Jews from Antioch and Iconium, who persuaded the people, and having stoned Paul, drew him out of the city, supposing he had
Check
been
this
dead."
Check this out. They preaching the gospel. Where did the persecution come from?
Jews.
Their own people.
Right.
Your own people going to turn on you. It's saying there came thither certain Jews from Antioch and Iconium, who persuaded the people, and having stoned Paul, drew him out of the city, supposing he had been dead. All for preaching the word. And we be ready to fold off of some little mouthy family members.
Come on, teach, bro.
Right? They say he was preaching the gospel and the Jews stoned him. Let's see what Paul did. Let's see if he threw in the towel. Go ahead.
Verse 20. "Howbeit, as the disciples stood around about him, he rose up and came into the city. And the next day he departed with Barnabas to Derbe."
So he came right back. They stoned him, thought he was dead. Yeah, I ain't dead. Came back teaching again. Go ahead.
"And when they had preached the gospel to that city and had taught many, they returned again to Lystra
and to Iconium and to Antioch.
All right, pay attention though. See what Paul said right here. These are the common temptations that should be expected while serving the Lord. Go ahead. It's not an easy road. If it was easy, you know, it wouldn't be really worth it. He's like, oh, it's guaranteed. I do what I want until then. No, I don't work like that. It got to be earned.
That's right.
So we should expect trouble.
That's right.
Coming in this word. Mm-hmm. And this is what Paul's going to let you know. Go ahead.
Confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue in the faith, and that we must, through much tribulation, enter into the kingdom of God.
Through little?
Through much tribulation.
Through no?
Through much tribulation.
As soon as you come into the word, when you start this walk, it's going to be a bumpy ride, but everyone is going through it. So Paul was stoned. None of us would have been stoned for the word. It says, confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorted them to continue in the faith.
That's right.
You have to continue. You can't just say, I believe, and that's it. You have to continue in the faith, and that we must, through much tribulation, enter into the kingdom of God.
Hallelujah.
Much tribulation. All right? Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 1. First Peter chapter 1. This is also to try us. Make sure we found worthy at his appearing. You just got to try you. Make sure you for real. Right? Ain't no faking with God. Pick it up at verse 1, bro.
Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through sanctification of the Spirit, unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. Grace unto you and peace be multiplied.
All right, so what sanctifies us? What separates us from the world? It says elect. Why are we elect? According to the foreknowledge of God, which is the prophecy of this book, mm-hmm. of God the Father, through sanctification of the Spirit. Mm-hmm. What is the Spirit? The words I speak unto you, they are Spirit and are life. So mm-hmm. the Spirit, the word of God, what else? Unto obedience. So you have to be obedient to that Spirit or that word of God, along with the sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ.
That's right.
So you need all three. You can't say, I believe and not keep the law. Mm-hmm. Or you can say, I keep the law, but don't believe in Jesus.
Come on.
Right? You can't say, oh, it's just the blood that covers me and I don't have to do anything.
Stop.
It says, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through sanctification of the Spirit, unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. Grace unto you and peace be multiplied. Go ahead.
Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead.
Right, so if Christ didn't raise, we would never raise. No eternal life if he don't die and resurrect. Go ahead and read.
To an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you.
All right, this is our reward we're looking for. That's why we can deal with what we got to deal with now. The poor, being sad. All right, it says we are resurrected to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you. So he's coming with your reward. Go ahead.
Who are kept by the power of God.
So we're going to be kept by the power of God. That's that word. Go ahead.
Through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time.
Right, that's when it's going to be revealed, no time sooner. Go ahead.
Wherein ye greatly rejoice, though now for a season.
So we greatly rejoicing in this, that our reward is coming with God. We greatly rejoice. But go ahead and read, though.
If need be, ye are in heaviness through manifold temptations.
What? If need be, so some of us need to be in heaviness. Some of us need to go through a lot of temptations. Some of us need to go through a lot of trials. Why? Go ahead.
That the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ.
Right, this for us, so we'd be sharp, so we'd be ready when Christ gets back. All right, so we would be found without spot, having no blemish when he returned. It says that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. This is if you don't fold, though. If you deal with this fiery trial, you'll be straight. Go ahead. Let's go to Romans chapter 5. Let's see a little bit more of these trials, these temptations. Romans chapter 5. It's the righteous thing to suffer. Go ahead. Romans chapter 5. And we're going to pick it up at verse 1. Go ahead and read.
Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace, wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of glory of the glory of
God. But that ain't it. That ain't it. What else?
And not only so, but we glory in tribulations
Why?
Also.
Why do they glory in our tribulations? Knowing Why is it good that, to go through this tribulation? Go ahead.
Knowing that tribulation worketh patience.
Yes, it's going to calm us down. We get a little high and mighty sometimes because we do be in our Bibles. We be following the word. We get a little puffed up sometimes. And we got to go through something first. We get that patience back. It's going to humble you. Go ahead.
Verse 4. And patience worketh experience. And experience hope.
Right. So we need that experience, though. Because when newcomers come into the word or people fresh in the word, run through these same tribulations you've been through already, you have the experience to teach them and coach them and help them
teach
through those tribulations and trials.
All right.
Unlike what Job's friends did, you don't want to do what they did. Go ahead.
And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us.
All right, so when we go through all these trials, we always feel like we're on the bottom. We ain't ashamed. We know what it's for. Right? And hope maketh not ashamed because of the love of God. That's the love of God, that he's going out of his way, you know, to acknowledge us. And we're going to read that. We're going to read that. Let's go to Hebrews 12. We're going to see it. Hebrews chapter 12. And we're going to pick it up at verse 1. Hebrews chapter 12. This will give us a lot of peace when we're going through this. Because we realize when we're going through this, that means the Lord knows who we are. We'll pick it up at verse 1, Hebrews chapter 12. Pick it up at verse 1, bro.
Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us.
All right, so it says, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses. So that great cloud of witnesses are in Hebrews 11. Those prophets, those disciples, those servants of God that went through these same temptations before you and overcame, right? They're going to raise up in judgment, and if you know, somehow fold, they're going to be standing in front of you. The Lord going to be like, you know, he had the same issue you had.
Right.
He overcame. That's why he appeared. But you didn't overcome. So it was a lake of fire for you. We don't want that. It says, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, it's too many. Let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us. And let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Go ahead.
Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God.
That's why we got to arm ourselves with the same mind Christ had.
That's right.
He knew what he was going through, and he knew why he was going through it. And he knew the reward at the end. He kept his eye on the prize. That's what we should do. We should never fold. These temptations are common. It doesn't happen to everybody. All right, we're going through it for a reason. All right? The kingdom is yours if you hold fast. Go ahead.
For consider him that endures such contradiction of sinners against himself.
Right, so he did it before you. People was on contradict him left and right. As soon as he say something out of the Bible, somebody be on him. Same thing that happened to us. All right? It says, for consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself. Go ahead.
Lest ye be wearied and faint in your mind.
Yeah, if you somehow weary, consider Christ. Go ahead.
Ye have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin.
Right, nobody trying to kill you because you're serving the Lord. Go ahead and read.
And ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children, my son. Despise not the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him.
All right, so when these temptations come, don't faint. The Lord is dealing with you as a son or a daughter. That means he knows who you are. Go ahead and read.
For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth.
Read that again.
Whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth.
Whoa. the Lord is dealing with you, if he's chastening you or punishing you, that means he loves you.
That's right.
And ultimately, he wants you to become a spiritual son of God. He said, for what manner of love hath the Father bestowed upon us that we should be called sons of God?
That's right.
For whom the Lord loveth, verse 6.
For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth.
Oh, you want to come over to my team now, right? But I got to whip you because you've been bad this whole time, right? I got to get you. But I love you, though. Go ahead.
If ye endure chastening.
If. Go ahead.
If ye endure chastening, God deal with you as with sons.
So if you don't, he ain't going to deal with you as a son. Is that right?
That's right.
Go ahead and read.
For what son is he whom the father chasteneth not?
Right. Everybody get it. It's common. This is common. Everybody gets it. Go ahead.
But if ye be without chastisement.
But if you constantly messing up and nothing ever happened to you, what does it mean?
Whereof all are partakers, then ye are bastards and
so
not
you're
sons.
You're a bastard and not a son. You don't want to be a bastard. They go to the lake of fire. So if you constantly tripping up and nothing happens to you, you should be terribly afraid. But if ye be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then are ye bastards and not sons. Go ahead.
Furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh, which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much more rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live?
Right. Who better than to get corrected by than the Father?
That's right.
Right. We reverence our parents when they whipped us, so we should reverence the Lord when he whipped us. All right. Because he's trying to turn us into something our parents couldn't, and that's God.
Amen.
Go ahead and read.
Verse 10. For they verily for a few days chasten us after their own pleasure.
After their own pleasure. I don't know how many whippings I got taken out on me as a stress reliever. For they verily for a few days chasten us after their own pleasure, but he for our profit, go ahead.
That we might be partakers of his holiness.
Yeah, to become God. Now, the present time, when you're going through it, it ain't fun.
Right.
Go ahead.
Now, no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward, it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby.
Right. This is all to establish you. This is all to settle you. Keep you calm. Keep your mind right. Keep you humble. All right? It says, now no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. Of course it is. Nevertheless, afterward, it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. So you're going to be way better than you were before. Go ahead.
Wherefore, lift up the hands which hang down and the feeble knees, and make straight paths for your feet, lest that which is lame be turned out of the way, but let it rather be healed. Mm-hmm. Follow peace with all men and holiness without which no man shall see the Lord.
All right, so in a nutshell, don't run from the pain, run towards it. All right, fight through it. All right, it says, wherefore, lift up the hands which hang down and the feeble knees. I know you're down. I know you're ready to give up. I know it's hard. It said, and make straight the paths for your feet, lest that which is lame be turned out of the way, but let it rather be healed. Go through it. You'll be healed. Let's go to Lamentations 3. And we go through this whooping for a reason. We was acting up in our youth. You know? We deserve to be dead, but through the mercy and grace of God, he just punished us a little bit. You know, that's what the baptism is all about, you know? You know, that the body might be destroyed or buried in baptism. That the body of sin might be destroyed. You'd rather destroy this body now than in the lake of fire. I know that.
I know that. Yes, sir.
Because if you're not baptized, I would suggest you do it now.
Yes, sir.
Now, we go through this chastisement or this whooping because we deserved it. You see, Paul, he was stoned for preaching the gospel, but before Paul was converted, he was wreaking havoc at the church. He had Stephen killed. So that little stoning was just the mercy of God. Did he throw in the towel, though? No, he accepted it. And this is why. Lamentations chapter 3, read verse 39.
Wherefore doth the living man complain? A man for the punishment of his sins.
You did it. What are you complaining for? When I decide to whoop on you, you getting upset, you ready to throw in the towel and give up. You did it. It's your fault. It says, wherefore doth the living man complain, a man for the punishment of his sins? What is he supposed to do? Go ahead.
Let us search and try our ways and turn again to the Lord.
That's what we're supposed to do. We don't say, you know, forget it. This is too hard. No, you turn. You mend your ways. You acknowledge your transgressions and you turn from it. Let's go to Jeremiah 31. Right, because we made plenty of mistakes in our youth, you know. Even before coming in the truth, I know myself, I say I wish I grew up in the truth. I know a lot of us say that. But we didn't. So we'd be thinking about the stuff we used to do, and we're like, man, why'd I even do that? Mm. Jeremiah 31, he gonna tell you, because he was thinking the same thing. Israel, it's all common, it's happened before. Jeremiah 31, pick it up at verse 17.
And there is hope in thine end, saith the Lord, that thy children shall come again to their own born.
Yeah, we're going to go back home eventually, but we got to deal with this captivity we in. But eventually we going home. Go ahead.
I have surely heard Ephraim bemoaning himself.
Ephraim, that's Israel. Go ahead.
Thus, thou hast chastened me.
Lord, you beating me up. Go ahead.
And I was chastened.
I was chastened. Uh-huh.
As a bullock as a bullock unaccustomed to the yoke. Turn thou me, and I shall be turned, for thou art the Lord God, Lord my God.
Uh-huh.
Surely after that I was turned.
So after I turned to the Lord, I've been tripping. The Lord bust me up. So after I turned to the Lord, go ahead.
I repented.
I repented. So I turned to the Lord. I stopped tripping. I stopped sinning. I stopped wilding out. And go ahead.
And after that, I was instructed.
And after that, I was instructed. What'd I do?
I smote upon my thigh.
Man, I said, why'd I do that?
I was ashamed.
Why was I acting up? Why was I doing? Man, I wish I grew up in this word.
Yea, even confounded, because I did bear the reproach of my youth.
Right. So before you got in this word and grew up, you was acting crazy. So you got to bear the reproach of your youth. Now, I think about it many a time. I was like, I don't know why I did that. Right? Mm-hmm. Has everybody felt that? I know everybody felt the same way. Okay. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Because it's all common. This ain't exclusive to anybody. It's happened to us all. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12. When you get there, brother, go ahead and read.
Wherefore, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed, lest he fall. There hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man.
See? We all been through it. It says, wherefore, let him that thinketh he stand, take heed lest he fall. All right, that's how Job's friends was thinking a little bit. They saw Job fall, and they kind of, you know, exalted themselves. But no, it says, there have no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. Everybody's been through this. Everybody's going through it now. Go ahead and read.
Middle 13.
Mm-hmm.
But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able.
All right, he ain't going to put you in a situation too hard for you. He going to ease up. He'll let you out. Go ahead.
But with the temptation also make a way to escape.
How you escape?
That you may be able to bear it.
How you escape? By being obedient. Mending your ways. I repented and turned. That's the way to escape. But we all been through these temptations, these trials. Go ahead. Go ahead to 1 Peter 5. You're going to see that again. This ain't nothing new. We all go through it. It's a little easier to deal with things when you know everybody's going through it or has been through it. Mm-hmm. And we're going to read that in 1 Peter 5. We're going to pick it up at verse 6. Go ahead.
Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your cares upon him, for he careth for
Always
you.
Always humble yourselves. So humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. Don't exalt yourself.
That's right.
Let him do the exalting. Mm-hmm. But we cast all your care upon him, for he cares for you. So when you're in trouble, don't turn to nothing physical. Don't turn to substances or physical things that may turn you away from the Lord. I'm not saying you can't drink or nothing, but don't do it on the Sabbath. You know, because I've heard or seen, you know, people doing things they shouldn't do on the Sabbath. Talking about, yeah, I'm going through it right now. I just need this. I just need this drink. I just need this cigarette. I got to do it. No. You want to turn to the Lord so he can help you.
Amen.
When you you're going through it, don't turn away from him.
Right.
And he got to turn from you.
Mm-hmm.
All right? So it says, cast all your care upon him, for he cared for you. Go ahead.
Be sober. Be vigilant.
Vigilant, why?
Because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour.
You see, he said the same thing to Peter. We're going to see that as well. Go ahead.
Whom resist steadfast in the faith.
All right, so a lot of folks is resisting your brothers and sisters. What? Go ahead.
Knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world.
So we all going through it. All these temptations is common. It's happening in the past. It's happening in now. We all being tempted. This is Satan trying to devour us all. All right? But we got to fight through these temptations, these trials. Right? So it said, whom resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. It ain't you only going through it. We all going through it. Right? Go ahead. Is that it? Verse 10, go ahead.
But the God of all grace, whom have called us into his eternal glory by Christ Jesus.
This is why are we going through this, though? Why do we go through this? Go ahead.
After that ye have suffered
a
while.
So after you suffer a little while, what is it going to do?
Make you perfect, establish, strengthen, set, and settle, and
that's
settle
all it's for. That's all it's for. Let's go see what the Lord told Peter. All right? Because we got to be able to, you want to do the opposite of what Job's friends did. All right, when you ever see your brother overtaken in the fault, we got to be there for him. Knowing that this is happening to all of us, we should always be here for one another because we all going through it. Right. And we're going to see what the Lord said to Peter. Luke chapter 22, and we're going to pick it up at verse 24. When you get there, brother, go ahead. Luke chapter 22, pick it up at verse 24. When you get there, brother, go ahead.
And there was also a strife among them, which of them should be accounted the greatest.
Right. So the disciples talking amongst each other, trying to say, I'm the greatest. We even do that in here, man. I'm more righteous, man. You was just tripping last week. Go ahead.
And he said unto them, the kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them.
Hey, man, chill out. The Gentiles do that stuff. We ain't a part of that. Go ahead.
And they that exercise authority upon them are called benefactors.
Uh-huh.
But ye shall not do so. No, sorry, ye shall not be so. But he that is greatest among you, let him be as the younger.
Yeah, so if you're so righteous, high and mighty, you see your brother or sister going through something, you should be the first one there. Go ahead.
And he that is chief as he that doth serve.
Mm-hmm.
For whether is greater, he that sitteth at meat or he that serveth? Is not he that sitteth at meat, but I am among you as he that serveth.
Yeah, Jesus is the greatest among all of us. He our God, but he coming to us as a servant. That's how our mindset should be when you see your brother going through these temptations. Right. Go ahead.
Verse 28.
Mm-hmm.
Ye are they which have continued with me in my temptation.
Whoa. You are who?
They which have continued with me in my temptation.
So you've been here with me while I've been going through these temptations. We supposed to be there for each other when we are all going through these temptations. We're supposed to be each other. We're supposed to ride with each other, just like the disciples ride with Jesus when he was enduring all these temptations. Go ahead.
And I appoint unto you a kingdom, as my Father hath appointed unto me, that ye may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom. And I sit on thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel.
That's what we want. Go ahead.
And the Lord said, Simon, behold, Satan hath desired to have you, that ye may sift you as wheat.
We just read that in Peter, right? He coming to get all of us. What did Jesus tell Peter?
But I have prayed for thee, that thy faith fail not.
Mm-hmm. So he praying for us. He praying for us as well. Go ahead.
And when thou art converted.
All right, so when you get through them temptations, what you supposed to do?
Strengthen my brother.
You don't do what Job's friends did. You supposed to strengthen your brother when they when you see them going through what you just got through. You're supposed to strengthen them. Don't talk down, bro. You acting crazy. I know it's got to be that. I know you acting crazy out there, man. But me, you know, I'm good. I don't never mess up. Man, we can't be like that. Let's go to Job. We're going to see it. We're going to see it right here. Job going to blow on his friends for that. And we're going to see what not to do. Job chapter 16. And we're going to pick it up at verse 1. Job chapter 16, pick it up at verse 1. When you get there, brother, go ahead and read.
Then Job answered and said, I have heard many such things. Miserable comforters are ye all.
Hey, I done heard a lot of things, but y'all not helping me at all. I'm just going through all these temptations, all these trials. I've heard many such things. Miserable comforters are y'all. Y'all not good for nothing. Why are you here? Y'all not helping me. I'm hurt. Go ahead.
Shall vain words have an end?
Man, when is these vain words and these empty words going to stop? Go ahead.
Or what emboldeneth thee that thou answerest?
What's making y'all do all this? Go ahead.
I also could speak as ye do.
Hey, if I was in y'all position, I could speak as you do. If nothing happened to me and I was chilling, I could speak as y'all speaking. But what would I do? Go ahead.
If your souls were in my soul's stead.
So if I was in your position, what would, go ahead.
I could heap up words against you and shake mine head at you.
Yeah, so if you was going through temptations, I could shake my head at you, saying you wrong. You messed up. I could do that. That's easy. But what would I do instead?
But I would strengthen you with my mouth.
So we are strengthened. See, y'all strengthen y'all, though. I see y'all going through these temptations. I would strengthen y'all. Y'all miserable comforters to me, but I would strengthen y'all with my mouth. Go ahead.
And the moving of my lips should assuage your grief.
Right. The wisdom of my mouth would comfort y'all grief. Brother and sister, I know I've been through it too. This is what you do. This is the scriptures you should read and study to help you get through the temptations. Let's go to Galatians 6. This is what Job's friends should have took if they could have. It's what we're supposed to do when we see our brothers and sisters going through something. Galatians chapter 6, we're going to read one verse. Pick it up at verse 1. Go ahead.
Children.
Galatians 6.
Oh, I'm sure.
Galatians chapter 6. Like I said, when we switch positions, or we're on the outside looking in, it's easy to talk down on somebody. What are we supposed to do, though? Galatians chapter 6, verse 1.
Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness.
So if you see your brother down, you're supposed to restore him. You don't kick him while they're down. The Lord doing that. That's not your job. You're supposed to uplift them. Go ahead.
Considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted.
You better consider when they're going through it that this could be you. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness. Considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. So you better be merciful to them because it could be you the next time. Tomorrow, literally in an hour, on your way home from the Sabbath, it could be you.
Right.
Let's go to Hebrews chapter 10. Let's see the importance of the Sabbath and how we should be using it effectively to uplift and strengthen our brethren that are going through these common temptations.
10 and 31.
Hebrews chapter 10, and we're going to pick it up at verse 31. When you get there, brother, go ahead and read.
It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God.
It sure is. When you're getting your head busted, it ain't cool. It's nothing you can do, literally. You just got to deal with it and keep obeying the word. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. But what are we supposed to do?
But call to remembrance the former days in which after you were illuminated.
So after you were awakened, that light switch went off, the understanding started to come in. What happened?
You didn't.
Right, when it start making sense to you, them afflictions come. As soon as you come in the word and it start making sense, you start to apply it, right?
Mm-hmm.
Great afflictions come. But it says they'd endure, though. Go ahead.
Partly, whilst you were made a gazing stock, both by reproaches and afflictions.
So you was made a gazing stock. Everybody looking at you like, what's gotten into him? What's going on? It says, partly, while you were made a gazing stock, both by reproaches and affliction. Like, he really going through it. As soon as he started reading that Bible, I don't know. All right, go ahead.
And partly, whilst ye became companions of them that were so used.
You became what?
Companions of them that were so used.
So when we come here on the Sabbath day, we companions.
Right.
of the same type of afflictions and reproaches.
Mm-hmm.
All our stories sound the same, pretty much. As soon as we read Matthew chapter 10 and 34, see, that's exactly what happened to me.
Right.
We all said the same thing. It says, partly why you were made a gazing stock, both by reproaches and afflictions, and partly why she became companions of them that were so used. Go ahead.
For ye had compassion of me in my bond,
mm-hmm.
and took joyfully the spoiling of your goods, knowing in yourselves that ye have in heaven a better and an enduring substance.
There it is. That's why we deal with all this. We got a better reward coming. That's Go ahead.
Cast not away, therefore, your confidence.
Mm-mm. Don't cast away your confidence. Even though your life is wrecked because the Lord beating you up, don't think you're doing something bad. Just continue in the faith. Keep pushing. Cast not away, therefore, your confidence. Go ahead.
Which have great recompense of reward.
Uh-huh.
For ye have need of patience that, after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise.
Uh-huh.
For a little while, and he that shall come will come, and will not tarry. Now, the just shall live by faith.
The just shall live by faith. Uh-huh.
But if any man draw back.
So if you get weary, you be like, you know what, this is too hard, I'm done. What we got to do?
My soul shall have no pleasure in him.
Yeah, we don't have no pleasure in those that fold, because we all done been through it.
That's right.
And what makes you so special that you don't think you ain't got to go through it?
Come on.
So you just quit?
No,
we
sir.
We don't have no parts with that. Let's see. Paul going to tell you. Go ahead.
39. But we are not of them who draw back into perdition.
Nah, you want to go back to destruction, bro? You good. You got it.
You
we
got
ain't
going
to chase. We don't chase nobody. All right? Our job is to give you the word. Our job is not to keep you here. So if you get this word and you dip off because you feel like it's too hard, that's on you. We're not chasing nobody at the door. When the rich man approached Jesus and he said, sell all you have and follow me, and the rich man didn't and walked off sad, did the Lord say, don't leave, brother. Don't leave. I was just playing. No. No, he didn't. He gave him the word. You either accept it or you don't. Our job is to give it to you. That's it.
Come on.
All right.
Come on.
It says, but we are not of them who draw back into perdition or destruction, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul. All right? Mm-hmm. So we all companions in here. That's why we don't forsake the assembling of ourselves together, because this is where we comfort each other. You know, how was your week? You know, it was rough. Don't tell me about it, man. Yeah, such and such, such and such. And y'all break that book open and get through it.
Mm-hmm.
And check on each other during the week. All right, let's go to 1 Peter. Chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2. And we're going to pick it up at verse 18. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 18. Let me get there, brother. Go ahead and read.
Servants, be subject to your own master with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the froward.
Right, you got a mean boss, you got a nice boss, treat them equally the same. But you're doing it for the glory of the Lord regardless. You do all things to the glory of God. Why are you looking to please him, not man? So whether they be evil to you or kind to you, treat them both the same. All right, servants, be subject to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the froward. Go ahead.
For this is thankworthy.
This is thankworthy. Uh-huh.
If a man for conscience towards God endure grief, suffering wrongfully.
All right, and you're going to suffer wrongfully in this word. The temptations, these trials, afflictions are brought on you because you serve the Lord, which is not wrong. But they'll make you feel like you're doing wrong, but you're suffering because you're serving the Lord. So it says in verse 19, for this is thankworthy if a man for conscience toward God endure grief, suffering wrongfully.
Right.
Go ahead and read.
For what glory is it if, when ye be buffeted for your faults, ye shall take it patiently.
It ain't much. You deserved it. For what glory is it if when he be buffeted for your faults, ye shall take it patiently? You take that patiently. Go ahead.
But if, when you do well and suffer for it, ye take it patiently.
Yeah, is this acceptable with God?
This is acceptable with God.
That's what God want to see. Somebody mistreating you for doing right and you taking it patiently. You're not reviling back. You're not snapping back. You're taking it patiently. That's acceptable with God. He pleased with that. Go ahead.
For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us,
mm-hmm.
leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps.
And what were some of his steps? Because he got beat on, spit. They pulled his beard out. He was beaten unrecognizably. What are the steps? And we get people talking bad about us. Nobody really swang on us, maybe a few times. What should we do? Do we snap back or what do we do? Or do we follow his steps? What were his steps? Go ahead.
2. Who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth.
All right, so for even hereunto wherein ye are called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps. Who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. Go ahead.
Who, when he was reviled, reviled not again.
So he didn't talk back or nothing. Go ahead.
When he suffered, he threatened not.
Right, he ain't say, I'm going to kill you. Nothing. He let it happen. Go ahead.
But committed himself to him that judges righteously.
And that's the Father. He could commit himself to the Father. You know, I'm going to deal with this because I know the glory coming.
That's right.
That's what we got. Arm ourselves with the same mind of Christ.
Amen.
Go ahead.
Who?
Go ahead, brother.
Excuse me, brother. Who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed.
What was we before this, though? Go ahead.
For ye were as sheep going astray, but now return unto the shepherd and bishop of your souls.
Mm-hmm. Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 4. We're going to pick it up at verse 16. So slide right over. 1 Peter 4, chapter 16. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 16. Go ahead and read.
Yet if any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on this behalf.
All right. If we suffering as Christ, as being Christ-like, ain't no need for us to be ashamed, right? Yet if any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on this behalf. Go ahead.
For the time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it first begin at us, what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel?
That's why we glorying. That's why you glorify God. You get this beaten now. It say, for this time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God. So if you're getting judged now, that means you are part of the house of God. That's what we want to be a part of. So we get this beaten now.
That's right.
So if we... for the time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God. So we're doing everything that the Lord requests of us, and we're getting our head beat on. We being judged now. What you think going to happen to them that do not obey the gospel of God? Lake of fire.
That's right.
Do you want it now or later? I'll take that beating now.
Yes,
go ahead.
Sir. Verse 18. And if the righteous scarcely be saved.
Scarcely. So we barely make it, and we getting our head beat on. What's for the ungodly? What they got to look forward to?
Where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear?
In the lake of fire.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Wherefore, let them that suffer according to the will of God commit the keeping of their souls to him in well-doing, as unto a faithful creator.
Right. So wherefore, let them that suffer according to the will of God, let them keep suffering. Right? For the will of God, commit the keeping of their souls to him in well-doing, as unto a faithful creator. No matter what we go through, we keep our bodies in subjection. Always. We don't get out of character. We follow the steps of God. But when he was beat on, he didn't fight back or nothing. Right. So we get, like I said, little reproaches here and there, people speaking evil of us. That ain't nothing.
Right.
We just got to continue to push forward. Mm-hmm. All right? Because these temptations are common. Christ went through it. Apostles, prophets went through it. So we ain't no better than them. We actually was worse. So we definitely got to fight and keep fighting and keep going.
Amen.
All right?
Amen.
Let's go to 2 Thessalonians. This is why we go through these temptations. This is what it's all about. This is why he's constantly telling us to rejoice. Not only because it's happening to all of you, right? But you are being found worthy of the kingdom. We'll go to 2 Thessalonians. We're going to pick it up at verse 1. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 1. Go ahead and read.
Paul and Silvanus and Timotheus unto the church of the Thessalonians in God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ.
Uh-huh.
Grace unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
We are bound to thank God always.
Why?
For you, brethren, as it is meet, because that your faith groweth exceedingly, and the charity of every one of you all towards each other aboundeth.
Right. So it's a, we are bound to thank God always for you, brethren, as it is meet, because that your faith groweth exceedingly. Right? The more you overcome, the more your faith going to grow.
That's right.
So your growth exceedingly, and the charity of every one of you all toward each other aboundeth, because y'all all been used the same way. All right, go ahead.
So that we ourselves glory in you in the churches of God for your patience and faith in all your persecutions and tribulations that ye endure.
What is this a sign of? All these temptations, all these trials, all these tribulations we go through just for serving the Lord. What is this a sign of?
Which is a manifest token of the righteous judgment of God.
Judgment's supposed to start at the house of God, right? Mm-hmm. Which is a manifest token of the righteous judgment of God. Go ahead.
That ye may be counted worthy of the kingdom of God.
That you may be counted what?
Worthy of the kingdom of God.
So if you're not suffering, if you're not going through these common temptations that all the prophets, apostles went through, are you counted worthy of the kingdom of God?
No.
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 Read that over.
Which is a manifest token of the righteous judgment of God, that ye may be counted worthy of the kingdom of God, for which ye also suffer.
All right. What about those people that was mocking you daily, speaking evil of you and of God? What about them? Verse 6.
Seeing it is a righteous thing with God to recompense tribulation to them that trouble you.
That's why vengeance is the Lord's. You ain't got to fight back. He don't deal with it.
Amen. That's right.
All right. We're going to hit you with one more verse. Matthew chapter 5. And we're going to get on out of here. Matthew chapter 5. We're going to pick it up at verse 10. And this should be it. Get there, brother. Matthew chapter 5. Pick it up at verse 10. When you get there, brother, go ahead and read.
Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake.
That's what we've been reading all day. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake. So you blessed when you being persecuted for serving the Lord. Go ahead.
For theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Uh-oh. So we going through all this trouble for serving the Lord. The kingdom is ours, ain't it?
That's right.
That's why you say rejoice in as much as you are partakers of Christ's sufferings. Go ahead. Verse 11.
Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake.
See? Blessed are ye when men shall revile you, right, and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely. Falsely. You see that? Falsely.
Falsely.
I mean, we on the right page. They falsely accuse us because they don't know what's up. We know, but salvation is of the Jews because we can read out the Bible.
That's right.
Follow everything in this word.
That's right.
So when they say, oh, you're not supposed to do that. That you sinning. You're not eating pork no more. That's a sin. You keeping the law. You sinning. The law can't save you. So it says, blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my name's sake. Last verse, and we out of here.
Rejoice and be exceeding glad.
Rejoice and be exceeding glad. Why?
For great is your reward in heaven.
Uh-huh.
For so persecuted they, the prophets which were before you.
Right. And that's the common temptations that's happening to all of us. Peace in Jesus' name. Hope you got some understanding. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to have a couple announcements. Or the regular announcements.
We welcome you and hope today's lesson is free.